item on the agenda is public comment. This is comment about any.
No, public hearing on the land use regulations.
Town of Randolph is considering amendments to their existing land use regulations. The proposed change would expand the central business district to include 8 to 12 Prince Street in Foundry Park. So this is to take comments on that.
Comments adopted, you want?
Yes.
Any comments on adding that to the central business district? Seeing none, anybody want to vote on that change?
I would make a motion to add the parcel to the central business district.
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Abstained? Done. Now we'll call the regular select board to order. And do public comment on anything that's not currently on the agenda. Paul?
Thank you, Madam Chair. My name is Paul Haskell. I represent an organization called Vermont Futures. It's a Randolph-based think tank that works on issues of economic development, community, civic, and social engagement. The purpose of my coming tonight, very briefly, and I promise to be brief, is to introduce the board to the concept of forming a rural economic development infrastructure district. This is something the legislature approved in 2017. Very quickly, a rural economic development infrastructure district, or a ready district, forms almost exactly the way a fire district is formed, which is to say a petition from members, from voters within the geographic area, petition the select board to form a district. There's a little bit of pro forma that is in the statute in terms of what information is presented to the select board and how it's evaluated. That being done, the select board has a role in helping form the initial governing board of the Ready District. And once the district is there, you now have a municipal entity which is capable of, among other things, financing, owning, and governing rural infrastructure. It was originally designed, as it's going to be applied in this case, to building fiber broadband, fiber to the home, or fiber to the premise broadband. The purpose of the municipal structure is twofold. One, of course, it enables financing at municipally tax-advantaged rates, which is helpful in bringing the cost down. It also does has a very important function, which is that it because it continues to own that infrastructure, it provides a quasi-regulatory environment. It doesn't necessarily control the rate setting, for example, and other things, but it has a strong influence on how those rates are set within the confines of a market-driven network. I'm not, especially because it's a time-consuming subject, I don't intend to get into the business plan aspects of it tonight, only to introduce the concept to you. We are looking now at a set geography, which is roughly the Stock Farm, Fish Hill, tributaries thereof, as a test bed for this concept. We have considerable interest in households all along those several roads in terms of bringing that broadband into the community. The advantages of doing it this way, in addition to the fact that it makes that service substantially more affordable. We're talking in the $45 to $49 range per month for a 15 megabit synchronous broadband connection. And there are several things that enable it, and at some point down the road, I'll be glad to share that with you and discuss that. But the other thing that it does is it opens up that part of that community to economic development, work from home, home-based business, as well as access to things like educational enhancement, healthcare, medical, the list goes on.
Did you bring the handout?
I did not. Sadly, I got deflected this afternoon and didn't get back home. So. But I will provide. I've given a physical handout to the town manager, but what I will do is make sure he has an electronic copy of the statute, which was slightly amended this year. So I took the liberty of blending the existing statute and the minor changes that were made in 2018, which reflect governance situations that we won't face here. But that all new statutory language I will make available, as well as the basic template for how we approach citizens and get them signed up.
I just forwarded your email to them.
It sounds like this has already been done, so I guess I have nothing to do. Thank you very much, Madam Chair.
So you're looking to get this back on the agenda?
We would like.
Or on the agenda to discuss what it is?
We would discuss it, and if. I don't know how you want to organize your engagement with us, whether a member or two of the board would like to meet independently and kind of get up to speed, or the concept is not unbelievably complex, but and for what it's worth, we've engaged in 2017. We engaged the town of Newberry in doing this, so it's gone through that process. There is a ready existing in Newberry. And it's gone through legal review by town council there, and the entire enterprise, as it came into existence with the legislature, was we worked very closely with Paul Giuliani, who many of you may know was significant involvement in almost every town that's financed a piece of infrastructure, and of course, you know, the other legal.
So that some members of the board meet with them independently to come up to speed. I send all the information to folks too, so you can also come up to speed on it, and then we'll have them do a presentation in August and then decide if it's something the town wants to do.
Mm-hmm. So but right now the model is Newberry, right? That's the current. They're the ones that, I think this is something CJ had explained.
If you've talked to CJ, then
right.
You're up to speed.
Well, I'm kind of. I got the concept. So
yeah.
Okay, it's that process that she had been talking about.
That's right.
Okay. I'd like to sit in on that.
And by the way, knowing that several or maybe all of you have some interest in economic development activities, these ready districts, though they were purpose-made for broadband, have other applications that you may want to consider and have to take a look at, because it allows different. It allows portions of communities and even towns. Say if you had two adjacent towns that have a comparable economic development agenda,
mm-hmm.
It works out. That's the. The flexibility of using that fire district.
I think she told me to go beyond the town borders.
Yeah,
right?
It can go beyond town. In fact, it need not even be contiguous.
Okay. Yeah, I wouldn't mind sitting in on something to listen a little bit about that.
Okay. So they have the information. We'll put you on the August agenda.
That would be great.
For more
and
detail, and then those, like, carry that.
We'll triangulate with whoever wants to meet and get that done. Well before August, so everybody's up to speed.
Great.
All right. Thank you very much.
Thanks.
Thank you.
Anybody else under public to be heard? agenda.
Yeah, I'll make a motion to approve the agenda.
Second.
Motion and a second, all those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed, abstained, motion carries. Next we have the consent calendar, which is last month's minutes, the warrants, and cemetery plot sales.
I move we approve the consent calendar.
Second it.
Motion and a second, all those in favors?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed, abstained, that carries. Next we have new business, starting out with a presentation of a resolution.
We recently had, as the board is aware, one of our longstanding and great public safety officers in the town of Randolph leave us in. Our loss is certainly the gain of royalty, but on behalf of the board, we pulled together a resolution with the board's permission, and we certainly would like to ask the board to present the resolution to former Sergeant and Acting Chief Loretta Stalnicker, who is now Chief of the Royalty Police Department. If the board would like to present it to.
You can propose?
Yeah. Or maybe if you'd like, just, could have just the chair.
We'll have the chair read that.
Yeah.
So the resolution says, whereas Loretta Stalnicker served as a member of the Randolph PD for over 18, I actually said Randolph Police Department, I shortened that. Randolph Police Department for over 18 years, during which she was promoted to the rank of sergeant and on multiple occasions served as the acting chief of police. And whereas Sergeant Stalnicker has also served as a member and chair of several committees, including law enforcement against drugs, the LEAD program that's in the schools, citizen advisory board, police design review, circles of support and accountability. And whereas Sergeant Stalnicker continues to serve her country with distinction as a member of the National Guard, served two tours of duty abroad, one 18-month deployment to Iraq in 2005, and a 12-month deployment to Afghanistan in 2010. And whereas throughout her tenure in all of the duties she fulfilled and the challenges she encountered, Sergeant Stalnicker maintained the utmost decorum, preserved the dignity of the Randolph Police Department, and countenance.
Oh, right.
Great word. Civility in every phase of engaging with the Randolph community. Now, therefore, the Randolph Select Board
publicly recognizes the rest of
her. Thank you.
Well,
that was too warm.
Thank you.
Sorry for the record.
Thank you. Thanks, Carla. Thanks, everybody.
Thank you.
So next on the agenda, we have Vermont State Police briefing. It's a public safety night.
My name is Lieutenant Roger Farma. I'm the station commander in Royalton, and I've offered to ask that I come and speak briefly about what we can and can't do with the village and what we have to offer and some of our limitations. And I thought maybe the best way to address that is just to bring you up to speed, that those of you that don't know what our responsibilities are, just tell you a little bit about that. Out of Royalton, we cover 19 towns, three counties, Orange, Windsor, and Addison. That includes about 114 miles of interstate. And last year, we took roughly 5,800 calls for service. And just in comparison, Randolph Village took around about 1,200 calls for service. So right now, on some of our staffing issues, we are down four troopers and one sergeant right now. So we're a little shorthanded, as is many other stations around the state. It's just kind of a common problem that we're having in law enforcement right now, filling vacancies. So we're feeling that pinch a little bit as well. As far as what we have to offer the village, obviously if there are any emergency calls and you do not have current law enforcement coverage, we will answer the call. We will come with whatever resources are required. The caveat being that the far corners of our patrol area being Reading, Plymouth, some of the back corners down there, it may still be 45 minutes, lights and sirens, for us to get here if we're that far away. So that's one of the drawbacks. It is a big patrol area, and we just may not have personnel to respond to all emergency calls at all times. I've spoken to Scott Kluot. It sounds like they will be doing a contract with you folks in the short term, as this kind of works itself through whatever process is going on. I've talked to him about after-hours calls. It sounds like he will be available for after-hours calls when we sign off. But I've spoken to him and Loretta as well, that obviously they're going through changes in Loretta now, and they're just a one- or two-person show right now. So we will backfill as necessary, as we don't want just one officer responding to a call if it's a call of a violent nature or something. It's just officer safety issues. So we may still send someone to either back up Orange County or Randolph or Royalton PD, whatever's necessary. That would be on a per call basis. I know there was some talk about the Waterbury model. I don't know if you want me to speak on that at all, or whatever.
Sure, yeah, if you would mind.
So that's obviously a pilot program that we're doing right now in Waterbury. As far as that being expanded to any other towns, that's years down the road. Basically, that only becomes a possibility once we become fully staffed as an agency, and I don't believe in our history we have ever been fully staffed. So that would need to happen first before we can hire additional troopers to fill these town contracts. So that's a long ways down the road as even a possibility for any other town. So Waterbury is a pilot program, but we're not expanding that anywhere else right now. So we'll see how that shakes out. But it really comes down to a staffing question, and we're just having a hard time filling positions within our agency, and all other law enforcement agencies are feeling the same thing. Do you have any other questions about what we can or can't do for the town? I know you're looking at a few different options on moving forward.
So I guess I have a question on the response. So if whatever the coverage may be in the town of Randolph, Orange County in the short term, they get toned out, do you guys hear that same tone, and do they, so you determine whether you respond, or do they have
It's all through the same dispatcher, so okay. Randolph uses the same dispatch that we do. So the way I kind of have it set up right now with our patrol commanders is that the call should go to them as well, and we'll determine whether we need to send someone.
So the Orange County doesn't have to request if it's something of violent nature that you
they
determine?
They shouldn't have to.
Okay.
Hopefully, if for some reason that they haven't heard that someone's responding, hopefully they'll make that request. And we're certainly more than willing to send someone.
Is your lack of staffing due to lack of candidates or funding?
Lack of candidates. Yeah, the funding is there. The current firm is working extremely hard to try to fill all these vacancies, but it's just we're having a hard time finding qualified candidates. And we're not willing to lower our standards for what we're looking for hiring. So we're just not getting as many applicants as we did years ago.
It's only 10% of people that apply we end up actually hiring. So we go through a lot of people before we make a roster to hire.
And it's a difficult process, and even some of the folks that make it through the process don't finish the academy. They just decide it's not for them, and we lose, after going through all of the steps that they have to get through just to make it to the academy, we then lose people during the academy that just decide this wasn't what they thought it was.
I think nationally there's an issue though.
What's that?
It's
nationally absolutely. Yes, yeah, not just
with everything going on, people aren't jumping into it.
It's law enforcement, it's volunteer agencies, they can't, no one wants to volunteer for work anymore, so it's a lot of issues going on right now that we weren't the same problems 10 years ago.
We're 30 when we get out of school and chose careers.
Can I just add one thing? Yeah, from my perspective, I'm the troop commander, so I oversee the five southern barracks, and Royalton is one of them, and I would just encourage the board to realize that, you know, we will not be able to offer you the level of service that you are used to with your own local department. I think you already know that, but I just want to kind of record, and us absorbing 1,200 calls would be, that's pretty significant. So we're encouraging you to do your best to keep a local department here and staff it as best you can, and we're more than willing to help, you know, in transition times and stuff like that, but it, we're not really built right now to absorb this community full time. So we, if that happened, we'd have to do some redesigning. So hopefully that's where you guys are going, is to keeping your police department and getting some different folks in, but just want to get that.
Or to a model where there's some level of,
yeah,
of more local policing than the state police, is what you're saying.
Yeah, I mean, we're built, right, we're really designed to offer emergency support, you know, all hell breaks loose. We know we have the resource, we can pull troopers from all over state for things, but it's the run-of-the-mill daily calls, you know, dog stuff, landlord-tenant disputes, mm-hmm, parking issues. That's the stuff that we're not built for that. We have 19 towns, is it 19?
Yeah.
In this area, so we've got to spread ourselves throughout 19 towns, and it leaves, you know, spreads us pretty thin. So for us to come in, take over this town full-time would not.
Just in comparison, when the PD was running at full strength, you had a chief and one officer working pretty much every day, day shift, Monday to Friday. My average shift right now is a sergeant and three troopers, so that's four law enforcement officers for 19 towns as an average shift. And some of that's due to staffing, obviously. We fluctuate depending on vacation and everything. We may have more than that, but I would say on average that we have probably four troopers working per shift right now to cover 19 towns and 114 miles of interstate.
And I think the contract with the Sheriff's Department is a good idea. That helps us out a lot, so we can help them, back them up when they need it. And their deal was 80 hours a week. That's helpful, that we don't have to carry that entire burden. We'll help them out as they need it.
How does the communication work? Because the town's PD got in with the state police for dispatch way back, mm-hmm, and that's continued until we discontinue it, from what I understand.
So
but the sheriff uses their own dispatch.
Temporarily, Orange County is still using the state dispatch. It sounded like they were doing some upgrades to their radio equipment, so we've basically offered it up to them free of charge, just continuing through as Randolph PD was doing for our dispatch temporarily. But it sounds like at some point they will be able to switch over and continue using their own dispatch through Chelsea.
But when they switch over, how does that then work for the backup? So if the calls that are all going now start going through Orange County, how do you find, you would only find out if they called you. They were proactive
and
engaging
you
for backup.
And that would be, you know, I think it's pretty limited on to who would be responding to calls in the village after hours. Probably Scott Clua, maybe the one and only, I'm not sure, but certainly a conversation I can have with him that if he receives information on a call he's being called out for and he thinks he needs additional resources to have him call our dispatch, and we'll call out people. But we can work the logistics of that out if and when they switch over to their own dispatch. I'm not sure what that time frame is.
Thinking it wasn't a guarantee that it would all be dispatched forever for you guys.
Right.
Yeah.
All right. So the last guy that came here, the Barracks Commander, his Explorer was all like polished to the hilt, and I had a conversation with him about who did that, and he said he did, and he offered me lessons on how to do it, but he never
followed through.
So you can make arrangements for that. I'd love to watch him polish.
Not one of us are.
No,
that thing was like shining right up.
Mine is all
good. He's like, I do it myself, and I was like, dang.
He's got a little too much free time on his hands.
So does the board have any questions? Like, I just want to do we have our point across? Just the gravity of, like, what that would cripple the barracks having to absorb, not shut it down, but it would be a tremendous
amount of work added that we're hoping that we don't have to do that if at all costs.
I'm hoping you don't have to either.
Yeah.
Okay.
As an alternative, though, and it's part of the conversation we can keep going forward, if money is available for state police troopers, but there are no qualified candidates or candidates that don't meet the threshold, or grants to municipalities available so that we could then potentially hire one or two local officers that may not meet state trooper threshold, but may meet Randolph Police Department threshold. But that's something we can continue to talk about,
right,
I guess,
be,
as an option.
Yeah, yeah. Nothing we would have.
No, that wouldn't be through us.
Yeah. Nothing that I don't know. I mean, I feel like we're doing a lot of talk, like, is there, I'm not familiar exactly, are you having trouble finding folks, or is it a money issue? Like, what is the biggest issue that you're facing for?
All of the above.
There's a variety of issues.
Yeah.
It's from the affordability of it. You know, it's the costs continue to grow.
Yeah,
Randolph has a very smaller defined area that the police district serves. So an increase in cost hits very few taxpayers, so any increase is drastic. Getting qualified folks or folks that even want to do it is an issue. I think when they changed what officers could do what, and what you had to have, that's having a ripple effect across the board. You know, you talked about some of these petty complaints. You know, it doesn't take the top of the line trooper that's got 15 years experience on the job to go tell somebody to knock it off type thing. So, you know, some of these are more like a community officer type thing than they are anything else.
Have you tried talking to other departments of similar size? Like a department pops in my head would be Bradford. That's like a 2-3 person department that's pretty successful. I don't know, that's just an option, just looking at how other people are doing it and cutting costs and recruiting and what they're doing to bring people through the door. Just
some of our challenges are having a regional hospital and the Clara Martin Center in town, and the types of support they need are not necessarily law enforcement support as much as their security guard or you know, a person on staff that can handle somebody that's out of control. And that's all fallen onto the police department for all these years. So some of it's redefining what that group does also. But we've formed a local community team to look at it, what it is, what should the service be, how should it be delivered, to try and define what that looks like.
John Lutz from Randolph. Is Randolph Center one of the 19 towns?
Yeah, it is.
How's that worked out?
As far as I know, it's going pretty well. I haven't heard otherwise. We don't get a ton of calls up there, but that's within our control area, so anything that does come in, we respond to that.
East Randolph is, too.
What?
East Randolph is part of the area, too. It works great.
So you know, anything outside of the village itself is covered by the state.
Thank you, Lieutenant.
Appreciate it.
Thank you.
Thanks.
The next up is the Orange County Sheriff's Department agreement.
We were expecting to have Captain Kapitansky and also Sheriff Poniak here.
We can wait on this. We can if
the board would like. I mean, I could also talk about the agreement, something that we've talked about in the past, but I was hoping that they could share some more information on what they've done.
Some time.
Yeah.
See if they come. Okay. Assembly permit for the Green Mountain Stage Race.
We have.
And there's no paving projects this year.
That's very exciting. I'm happy to tell you more about the event. You were kind enough last year to allow us to have the event in town, and I was hopeful that it would take place. So the Green Mountain Stage Race is just to for people who weren't here, but a refresher recollection, it's a 4-day bicycle stage race. This is the 18th year of the event, and it brings racers from around the U.S., Canada. We always get some European racers as well to come and race in Vermont for 4 days. The race starts on Friday. That's the first stage. It's over in Warren. Starts in Warren Village. And I'm looking to have the second stage, which would start in Randolph. It would be on the 12A loop. So each loop's about 37 miles. We'll have 10 fields of racers. Each field is led by a police officer. There are officials in vehicles and also on motorcycles. We have emergency medical services also, as well as service for the racers. So each field starts on its own, and it's made up with similar experience level racers, and they have a rolling sort of caravan as they go around this loop. If racers have a flat tire and they get service and can't catch back on, or they get dropped, then they're out of the caravan and they follow the rules of the road effectively. We have police at the intersections. This is a pretty straightforward course in that there's really only 3 turns. That's pretty basic. 2 of them are pretty close to each other. I last year worked with Sergeant Solnecker, who was the chief actually, briefly for that time. We had worked out some coverage for the race. I understand now I work with the sheriff's office or hire a flagging company. The state police also work the race. They typically are doing the lead vehicle. The way we run the race is we'd be starting at the high school. Last year I had approval. I haven't heard back from them yet, but I'm continuing to chase around on that. We'd start at the high school and stage there. There would be 5 fields starting in the earlier morning, and then we'd start 5 more fields once the first 5 are finished. And we'd be finishing up at Harrisburg Boat Farm. That would be where the finish would take place. And there'd be a little bit of a feed zone just across from the high school. They don't stop to get something to eat. They just ride by and people hold it out and grab it as they run by. And that would be the race. Most of the fields will do 2 laps for 74 miles. 1 field will do 1, and then 2 fields will do 3. And there's sprints on each lap. We'd be up at the finish line. I don't know what else I can tell you about the race. We have insurance, which I've forwarded on to the town, as well as information that's contained in the permit. The race has done well. I expect we'll have 650 or 750 racers. A little hard to know. People sign up late in the process of registration. I don't know what else I can tell you.
Is there any type of event at the end, or they're done and?
When they're done, they're probably hungry and they're coming to town to get something to eat. It would be great if I could figure out a way to run the race through town. And I think that would be a nice opportunity. I'm not quite sure how to make that work really in the end. But I also don't want to be disruptive. I mean, this keeps it sort of a little bit more in the outskirts of town. There's an award ceremony, but that isn't until after the officials process the results. So that isn't until later that takes place. But it will bring people here in advance of the event because the racers like to preview the course. You're not going to see 100 people show up one day, but they'll come in different groups and ride the course in advance, and they will get things they need as they're in the area, whether that's gas and food, that sort of thing. And it will bring people to the area in general. Certainly on the day of the race, not only are there the 650 or 750 racers, they also come with about 1 person. Some people come with their whole family. Some people come in the team and they have 1 person that, 2 people that are taking care of their needs. So it's another 600 or 700 people that come along with the race. So that's pretty much the race. I'm happy to answer any questions that you might have.
I should mention that the permit itself, although staff and me have not been able to obtain all the signatures on the form. I have spoken with our health officer. She's okay with it, just hasn't signed the form. Sheriff's Department has also reviewed the form and they are okay with it, just have also not signed the form. And our Highway Department, our Public Works, has listed in the form, is also okay with the event, also have not just signed the form.
Anybody have any questions?
I'd make a motion to approve that.
A second.
Motion and a second. All those in favor?
Aye.
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 Opposed? Abstained? Motion carries.
Great, thank you very much. I will hope to have the event here for a number of years. I mean, the pavement has certainly gotten quite good, and I guess, you know, we'll see how it goes. Hopefully we'll want to have it again. And if there are concerns or complaints, I'm glad to come address them however you like after.
It would be nice to coordinate it with the Beer Fest.
When is that?
I don't know, it's right on the
coordinator. Yeah. Bikers just do like beer, so that's, you know, that's always very popular. But, feel free to reach out. I do tell select boards that say, oh, this is all fine and good, but I know I get complaints that I gave away free money. People say I didn't give them enough, so I may be the same with this as well. And some people don't like the disruption, and it slows traffic down occasionally. And, you know, they'll ride fast, but sometimes it's not as fast as the traffic wants to go. At the finish, we will have, I work with some constables from over at Warren, and then one of them may come over and help, but I may also have another law enforcement officer there. Just so you know that when we do radio communication within the race and within each individual race, but they also can talk to the police around the course. So they will stop traffic when they come in to sprint each lap, just to keep it safe. They'll stop traffic so that there won't be any cars. No racers end up with hood ornaments in the car. So if they're approaching the finish, they'll stop traffic that would be approaching so they can get through safely and then the traffic will go through. So it should be pretty minimal disruption on that road when, you know, when that happens. We'll have police doing that as well.
Great. Good luck.
Great. Thank you so much.
Thanks.
All right.
Thank you.
Be in touch.
This is the water wastewater ordinance amendment. Good timing.
Yeah. I wonder how I knew how to come down.
So I kind of gave you guys a brief overview of some of the major changes. The last meeting, you have in front of you an annotated version of the pages that were changed from the water ordinance. And how would you like to go about this? You want me to kind of quickly go through what each of the changes are, or what do you want to do with this?
Still looking for my historical data.
Your historical data?
Can we talk about providing a little bit of information about what the impact fees were over the last so many years?
How much?
Yeah, what was the effect? What were those?
Yep, I didn't pull those together. How much we collected, you mean?
Yeah. But you know, my pet peeve is I want to eliminate those.
Right. No, I didn't get to do that.
Okay.
That doesn't necessarily change here because you can set the fee at zero.
No, I understand that.
That
was just a piece of the puzzle I was just trying to figure out, just how much of an impact that really had on the overall operating budget and expenses of running the water and the sewer.
That doesn't have any on the operating and maintenance expenses because it all goes,
but it goes into this. I know, but I want to know how much it was to see whether or not what that money, what we were getting every year from that.
Got it.
Okay. So
we can get that for you.
Thank you.
Sorry about that.
That's okay.
So how do you want me to like quickly go through what the changes are, or did you have any questions about specific changes?
Why don't we do that, Marty? Let's go, we're proposing the changes go down and maybe talk a little bit about
why they're there
and if it's just something as easy as it's just a change in the number, then we can just say it's changing the number.
Okay. So on section 205, the town manager, this gives flexibility to have the town manager make a decision when the ordinance might otherwise say it has to go to the advisory committee first. But still he keeps the committee in the loop as to what decision he's making, and he can get their input via email. It's just an advisory committee anyhow. They have
mm-hmm.
no decision authority.
Right.
Section 210 is completely new. It allows for variances of any of the provisions that can be varied. Like there's some that can't. You can't vary the assessment of interest and penalties on delinquent bills, accounts, because that was authorized by vote of the district users. Mm-hmm. So some things can't be waived. But this allows for variances in unusual circumstances, unusual and unique circumstances, so that it's not likely to set a precedent. And then the process is it gets heard by the committee first, and then would go to whoever the appropriate person would be. It could be the superintendent, it could be the town manager, or the select board. And some of the variance criteria there at the bottom under D is kind of taken from zoning variance criteria to a point. And it's not quite as strict, quite a bit not as strict.
Okay.
Stop me if you have any questions.
Nope, I'm good so far.
Section 213, you'll see in the middle of the first paragraph there that we are specifically indicating that we town personnel can go onto private property to read meters. Mm-hmm. That was an issue for some of the Herbroy on one particular property.
Yeah.
There's just a kind of a technical change on the last paragraph in 214. In 215, billing abatements, this is kind of what we talked about last time, where someone has a huge abatement and they actually use very little water, so, and they pay the bill, which means normally it would just go as a credit to their account, but it would take them 5 years to pay off that credit, to use up that credit. So this is allowing a refund in that case if it's going to take more than three billing periods based on average usage to basically use up that credit.
So sorry not to be picky. On 214F above, I think we just need to add the with that in.
Yeah, that's above 214F, hold on.
Yeah.
Did I delete too much there?
Yeah, the width probably should remain.
Yes, thank you.
It works, man.
It works.
No, it's good.
That's my grammar for the year.
Okay. Okay. All right.
Allowable abatements. We've seen this happening with the construction last summer and a little bit of this summer. You know, sometimes there's unforeseen repairs or construction results in turning off the water main, and when we shut down the water main, when you turn it back on, it can rile up the water and cause it to be discolored.
Mm-hmm.
And we've been typically granting people a 100 cubic foot abatement on both their water and wastewater when they've had to run due to
clear the water.
Clear the water.
From a flushing situation or something.
Yep. So that's what that allows. And the next amendment under C kind of just ties into that.
Mm-hmm.
F, very last part of that section, is this was requested by Chris, saying that sometimes his crew is out there and they have to do something, and it just allows them to authorize that 100 cubic foot abatement in the field without having to go through any real process. Just so you know, under current rates, 100 cubic feet on both water and wastewater amounts to a total of $20. So it makes the customer feel better knowing that they don't have to pay that, and it's not a huge hit on the operating budget. Moving on, Article 3. This clarifies, hopefully, although it was kind of hard to word, so if you want to do some wordsmithing, please do, that one and two family residences that are on an existing lot or part of a small subdivision, i.e. a two-lot subdivision, if it would require a service connection longer than 200 feet, or, as it says there, would have to recently traverse the ledge, wetland, whatever, do not have to connect to the public system. So if you have a piece of property that you're creating a subdivision of three lots or more, and regardless of how long it's going to take to tie those houses into the system,
you have to tie into the system. It's just part of the cost of subdividing and developing those lots that you're creating.
So, ignorance, what's the significance of 200 feet?
We didn't change that. That was just in there. We just figured, I think, that if you have to go longer than 200 feet, you can get pretty costly in having to put in that service line. Your house would have to be set back pretty far.
Mm-hmm.
You can change that if you want.
No, I just didn't know if there was some engineering type.
No. No, that was just a discussion when this was originally adopted in whatever 2000 and something to set it at 200 feet. Section 303, this is basically nothing we came up with. It's out of state statute. It's just putting what's in state statute into the regulations. Right. I don't know if there's any issue with that. Any issues? Okay.
Nope.
Now we come to the excess fees. This is what the committee came up with for a recommendation on how to hopefully ease the pain of the excess fees. Single family residences have to pay 100% up front. That actually doesn't change. That would have happened the way it was written now, anyhow. For all of the uses, regardless of how much the allocation fee, excess fee is, you pay 20% upon that first invoice, and then you start getting invoices after you've actually started using the systems, the services. So you get, your first billing will not have any, the excess fee will not be assessed on your first billing, it'll be for subsequent. 20% increments. And then the next section just talks about what you do when it's phased. It's basically you pay 20% for the whole thing up front, and then 20% for each phase after that in the four billings. Any questions? Okay, moving on. Hydrants, 504. I think I mentioned last time we have an issue of someone who's built a fence that hinders the ability of that hydrant to be open fully without a lot of extra work, which can take up time for the fire department. So this kind of clarifies what it means and how far you have to, how much clearance you have to provide on a hydrant. Just know that this is not one of the provisions that obviously would be mirrored in the sewer district ordinance because it's not a sewer issue.
Right.
And then lastly...
So I'm sorry, are existing structures that violate this grandfathered in them?
Like that fence? No, because we've already talked to them about that. We've got to follow up on that, but yes. No one's grandfathered on that because it just clarifies it. Maybe it's in a, what the obstruction is. Yeah. What distance you have to maintain clearance. Then the last one, in section 511, sets up a clearer process for kind of what we're going through with LED dynamics. It sets up a process whereby someone has to request for a water line or sewer line to be accepted by the district, and then you guys decide whether that's in the best interest of the district to do that and issue a notice of intent. Then the permit, construction permit gets issued, and then they have post-construction requirements they have to meet, as-built, you know, testing, satisfactory testing results before it gets finally accepted. But that way, at least, they know going into it that you intend to accept it as district property. And it does allow the district to accept already built infrastructure, kind of like what we're doing for the Freedom Foods.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. So those are the amendments. There's slightly different wording for a couple of the provisions, like the water abatement one, you know, for having to the 100 cubic foot for
running your water because it's discolored. In the sewer ordinance, those will be prefaced by for customers who are connected to the public water system, kind of thing. Just to make it clear, if someone has a private well, doesn't get to have their sewer abated just because something is mucked up in their private system.
Not
that
but if they're not on
either.
Right.
This doesn't apply.
Okay.
Oh, and there is one other thing that I think was talked about. It didn't get put in here, but it's on your action item sheet, that if you want the new payment schedule to be retroactive, then you would add in that language that's in D on the action item sheet here.
Any questions?
I just have a comment on 205, the town manager's section.
Yeah.
Should we restrict it to email? Or should it just be written communication?
Solicit comments. Right?
Yeah, soliciting the comments. You know, if somebody walked in here with a piece of paper, it doesn't meet the rule. I realize it's ticky-tacky, but...
You can just take out via email.
Yeah.
Yeah,
you can take out
via
email.
Just take out via email?
Yeah.
Take out via
email.
This is in section...
205B.
205.
Okay. No, you don't have. What happens with these ordinances is that you can adopt it, and then the notification happens. It's effective in 65 days, barring a petition to take it to a vote within 45 days. I don't know why they have that difference of 45 to 60. It's like, there it is.
Okay.
Pleasure.
I'm going to make a motion to accept this as written and include that little letter D there so that we can at least make this retroactive.
Could be changes that Matt and
as modified, not written.
Modified, as we just modified, correct? Right. Those are changes like you just made about your email. So.
For both the water and the sewer ordinance?
Yes.
I'll second it.
Motion and a second. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Abstained? Motion carries. Next, we have to set a public hearing date on the town plan.
I'm not sure if we'd like to revisit the agreement with Orange County Sheriffs. Or
yep, we will in just a second.
Okay.
But Marty has the town plan one too.
I'll get you there.
I have a couple other things.
Her items.
Okay. Sorry, guys. You're gonna
She's
have
been
to
sitting here longer.
I apologize for that.
That's okay.
I thought of a court. So.
There we go.
We weren't more important in court.
It's pretty sad we were taking a baby away from both moms.
Not
so.
Good.
Good.
All right.
Yeah. We'll take the second seat. Town plan.
Town plan. So the Planning Commission held its public hearing on Monday, and there's been fast and furious emails going back and forth on the final tweaks to it, but they are ready to submit it to you, and they would like to have you set at least one, if not both, public hearing dates. They can't be any sooner than 30 days.
Do we have the plan?
So the reason we don't have a plan just yet is because the Planning Commission can still make some tweaks and changes until it's actually noticed that 15-day notices occur. So they still have like another week and a half or so to finalize it, and you will have it by the time the public notice is made.
So this says the final draft for the select board will be available on the 12th.
And I did that up before we had our public hearing.
She can email you one right now that probably would be work.
I could.
Would work.
I could. But I didn't, you know,
let's
I figured why.
Habitat connector.
I didn't want to like print out 88 pages and to have it not all be what will be presented to the public at your public hearing.
So we need a date in August. The select board meeting is on the 9th, so that won't work.
Yeah, no, unfortunately.
By 2 days.
Yeah.
Unless we change the day of the select board meeting to the 16th. Is this a controversial changes in the plan?
That depends on who you ask.
Well,
good answer.
I don't know. I don't think that it's, there's a lot of, I think that my opinion is that I think we worked through all the pieces with everybody regarding the, I think the hot buttons were the energy part, which, you know, we really can't fix because we, in order to do that, we need an enhanced energy plan, which we haven't had time to do. So I think that what we, I think what we came up with was there were a lot of public comments over the last three meetings, and we've been able to include most of those. So I don't think that that was much of anything else that was controversial. It was mostly the energy portion, which I think we've addressed, and the Planning Commission's thoughts were that once we got through the town plan, we could go back and then start working on an enhanced energy plan with Two Rivers because we still are engaged with Two Rivers until spring.
Right.
So.
And the Planning Commission wants to kind of form a subcommittee with members of the Energy Committee,
right,
and Planning Commission and interested public to really kind of lead the charge on this enhanced energy planning, because the Energy Committee should be involved. In a lot of other towns, it is the Energy Committee that does the work. So that's what we're going to do.
So do we want to set a separate date for the first hearing of the plan, or do we want to adjust the select board meeting to put them together?
I don't know. Is there any reason not to move the select board meeting back a week to take it from the 9th to the 16th? Is there anything that you could think of that would create an issue?
No, it's just if we staff properly warned the meeting and the board is accepting of it, then.
Right. I know you're going to be away for a period of time there in between, so that's not.
No.
You'll have, this might even give you a little more time to be back, right? There's no other pressing issues that we can see that need to be addressed probably by the 9th.
Yeah.
So I would be in favor of setting this back a week so that we could do this public hearing at the same time we do the select board.
So we would make it August 16th and September 13th.
I just know I'll be in England that weekend. I'll leave that week.
Skype you in.
Yeah.
Do you need help for that trip?
Yeah, I do. Wait till the next one. Next month's Australia.
There you go. That's the one you want.
Never been there.
There you go.
I got your attention.
Hey, Mike, does that work for you?
Yeah, I'd go to Australia. Yeah, 16th.
That's the September meeting, right?
So, yeah, that would work because if you guys decide to make significant changes, it'll still give you time to do that before the second hearing has to be warned. Because once that hearing, if you make any significant changes, you have to warn a new hearing. So we're trying to hit that September 17th deadline. So as long as you make your significant, if you make any significant changes, they're done pretty close to August 16th. Then, or the week after, you should be good.
Okay.
Sorry,
good. Put those August 16th, September 13th, adjusting the select board meeting to the 16th in August.
Select board meeting August 16th to accommodate an August 16th hearing and the second hearing on September 13th.
Okay. Next, we have a project change order for Elm Street.
So you should have something else before that. Oh, no, I'm sorry.
No.
I'm out of order.
Belford yes. Drive is after.
So it's pretty self-explanatory. I think I hit all the highlights of why we need this change order.
We just did add some more context here. Morgan's right in that we had some major issues that we discovered. Discovered along this entire project. This being the most recent one, in that I think the pipe burst a few weeks ago.
There was a plug in the sewer line.
Plug in the sewer line. We found that that entire pipe is just in need of replacement, which then spurred this conversation, and now we felt it was appropriate to make this recommendation.
The manholes and all that, that's all in the septic budget anyway, right?
In the sewer budget?
Yeah, in the sewer budget. All those expenses. There was a comment about that it didn't make a large net change for the overall project, but the overall project was paid for out of different sections of the budget.
This would be entirely
wanted to make sure that we were tracking it separately, even if the overall wasn't
Yes, this is separate.
I suppose that they're going to wonder if we're ever getting out of that neighborhood.
Yeah, well, sidewalks and curbing are starting to go in this week, so you know that's a good sign.
That should feel a little better.
Thoughts on the change order?
Sounds fine to me.
Make a motion to move $29,600 for change order.
I'll second it.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Abstained? Motion carries. And now your last one is renumbering Belford Drive.
I know. I hate to
How
do
many
this.
Homes are up there?
There are 8 homes plus the one that used to be on South Main Street. So it's not a fun thing to do by any means, because it is a hassle. But I've been told by the E911 board that you need to have it happen for the people up there. So I just want to make sure I have your blessings before I have to do this and people start squawking.
So then they can call us, right?
No, there is.
Still call me.
There's only 8 of them. I can deal with it.
You could take 4, I'll take 4.
Sure.
Yeah,
odds or evens.
Yeah. I'd move to authorize.
I remember you both said that.
Yeah, you can forward the calls, right?
Yeah, forward the calls.
Yeah, the select board made that decision. I was.
I mean, quite honestly, a lot of the unpopular changes I have to make, because they're huge inconveniences to people, they're wholly supported and driven by the E911 board, state board addressing standards. So.
Well, when it comes time for somebody to find them, they're going to be glad that they've got.
Absolutely,
right.
Especially if they can't talk. You know what
Correct.
I mean?
Correct. Right.
And it's not a proper address.
So, all right. So I would make a motion to give permission to Marty to renumber the residences on Belford Drive. Mm-hmm. Oh, it's official. I can take the hit. You know, call me. No one wants to second it, though. You don't want the other vote calls.
I'll second it.
Oh, there we go. There's a brave guy.
Motion and second. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
That was the first response.
Just on Belford Drive, we'll find it. It's not that long.
No, right. Exactly. They can't talk. You know,
like, if they have one of those buttons you got to push and they can't.
Somebody may not know the area so well, maybe trying to find 20 South Main Street and not be able to find it or go to the wrong place. That's basically what it is.
Bill's up there shaking his head, yep, I think that's a good idea, right? Okay.
Good. Back to Orange County Sheriff.
All right.
Okay. Jerry Ward's going to come to pick that up.
Oh, today?
Yeah, tonight.
Okay.
Thank
that's
you.
That's a good morning.
Thanks.
Good morning.
Good evening.
I do apologize about what happened
today.
Sorry,
we just changed it around a little bit. We're flexible.
Nobody.
As long as you got here before we adjourned.
Yeah.
No, that was after I sent Adolfo the email and say, are we up close to the top of the agenda?
We got to the top.
I don't want to be out all night.
Yeah,
I don't
want
to be out all night.
All right.
So we, the town and Sheriff Pontiac and his team have been working on the transition that the town is in, the police district is currently in. We have a draft agreement that the town and police town staff and the sheriff's department is open to. Much of it was pulled together through, in collaboration with the sheriff's department. Provides for officers, including supervisors, shift breakdowns. We did not include the actual shifts that the officers will fill, just because we want to ensure that that's information that is not necessarily out there and certain element not plan around shifts that are available. But we do feel that this is a an agreement that would be mutually beneficial to both the sheriff's department and the town and the police district residents. So we're hoping that the captain and the sheriff can speak about some of their work that has been ongoing since the department, the Randolph Police Department has gone down to one officer, and some of the changes there or improvements that they've made in the last 7 days.
I'll start with, you know, I'm working closely with Adolfo. There are several things behind the scenes that's going on. Everything from, you know, now we have Orange County deputies using the radio frequency out of Royalton, which is on a temporary basis. I don't know how much the lieutenant shared with that, but so that's on a temporary basis. They got no problem with it. Also with still having one Randolph officer working, there's things that behind the scenes that need to be done. There's the record keeping for any, for the date records management system, the database, that's gotta be updated every time Matt works. Any traffic tickets he does, cases, you know, make sure that they're all approved and then submitted to the state's attorney's office in a reasonable time. Little things like that behind the scenes that are going on. We also had a request for another agency wanted to buy some of Randolph's equipment.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, the captain worked directly with Adolfo and basically very politely said, until a decision is made, the department's going to be disbanded. Nothing's going to be removed from the department. Any, you know, we're not going to go sell them at the off or having, you know, Adolfo selling anything off at this point. I'm in a process of, you have the repeater that's on the PD. We're looking at switching that to the Orange County frequency, just to give, once the state police have enough of us on their radio system, that will just transition to my dispatch. That will have no cost, you know, to Randolph, you know, with Matt, you know, Matt Chin working. So that should be pretty seamless when that happens. Anything else I'm missing? I did ask the captain to also attend. I wanted, you know, this way you have a face. Because if I'm not around, the captain will be, you know, able to answer questions for me. And that was one of the reasons we talked about the supervision. It's either going to be the captain or myself here doing that role. Currently we have Scott Coulot, who's a lieutenant for us. He's going to be primarily working day shift. And then we're working with Matt Chin on his schedule. He'd like to change it, and we worked it out where next month we'll accommodate his changes. So we're working with him and also just making sure between, you know, myself and Adolfo, we're not, should make sure there's no union issues. So
No, I mean, operationally and procedurally, that's, things are kind of status quo, it's just different uniforms, really. The working hours may be a little different, but they're going to be, I would say, comparable coverage even now. I will happily report that, as the sheriff said, Lieutenant Kluot is going to be here 40 hours a week. In addition to that, with some exceptions, because we may have a different deputy that comes in to do patrols here and there, but the two other deputies that primarily we're going to have, one of them is a canine handler, that, and the canine is trained both in odor detection, so narcotics and finding people, and he's also trained in criminal apprehension. And we have a drug recognition expert as well who is able to come out and screen people for DUI other than alcohol and make that determination about what they have in their system. So we've got some very skilled deputies that are going to be here working as well.
Sounds good. Questions?
So I guess I have a couple. So when I, you know, like math and all that stuff, I see like a delta of about 80 hours a week if I'm looking at what we can contract versus what the previous coverage was. I guess from your guys' professional opinion and exercising this, I mean, what kind of gaps does that leave in the town, and how do we mitigate any of those risks for that uncovered time?
Right. Well, currently, the shifts that are not covered, the Vermont State Police will respond to any emergency calls, serious calls. Otherwise, if they're non-emergency, they're going to be stacked up. And then in the morning, the day shift officer, if it's during the week, Lieutenant Kluot will take care of those. You know, just put it this way, if we have a real serious incident in town, both the captain and I are, we're a few minutes away, as you know.
Yeah.
So, you know, yeah, it wouldn't be the first time that either one of us got called out in the middle of the night to handle, you know, an emergency situation.
Right.
So.
What chances are you'll be quicker than the state police if they're in Reading?
Oh, yeah. I think one of the big differences between us now versus Randolph PD is we don't currently have a mechanism in place for on-call time. So, whereas Randolph PD was on-call in their off hours, aside from Matt, who still is operating under the same schedule that he was before, our deputies don't have anything built in for on-call as of right now. And of course, that being said, if there was a major emergency, like the sheriff said, either one of us or both of us would certainly be here, regardless of that piece of it.
You know, as far as scheduling, you know, I know it's being recorded, and I just don't think it's
understood.
It's appropriate to talk about, you know, different scheduling for the public to, because we've been working on some ideas to maximize our time in town, mm-hmm. and I'd be happy to, in the closed session, happy to discuss those with you.
My question wasn't more about any specific hours, it was more about the delta total hours per week is what I was concerned about.
You know, one
from a coverage, two from a perception.
Sure, and you actually have around 105 hours.
Okay.
Because of the supervisor's time that's built in. I'm going to be covering a lot of that, but in my time here in town, a lot of it is actually going to be out doing patrols and answering calls as well. So that'll offset some of that time as well.
We're also still going to be working with some of the more the social service calls in a better way to cover those, correct? So that whether that's a direct contract with them or...
You mean like Clara Martin or things at Gifford?
Hospital.
Yeah, and of course Gifford, I mean the protocol would still remain if someone's in danger at Gifford, if there's an assaulted person or whatever, of course we're going to respond, but after that's under control, we won't have the deputy that's assigned to village patrol sitting at Gifford all day long. We'll bring another deputy in, do a mental health contract or what have you, however
however this
and
is.
And that's a chunk of that delta, those type of calls.
Yeah. We did have a sit down with Adolfo and myself, Dan Bennett and from Claire Martin, and we all chatted about, you know, the way things are going to be handled in the future. And, you know, nothing really was written in stone, but Gifford and Claire Martin do know that there's changes coming, you know. So Gifford pointed out they're spending six figures on their private security. They made that very well known. So.
Mm-hmm.
There been any outreach to the school system? You guys chatted with Lane?
Oh, yes. Also, the school system.
You know, Lane was actually at that meeting.
Lane was at the meeting, too?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yes.
I just want to make sure all the bases are covered.
Yes.
They have a resource officer?
No, they're looking.
They're looking at having one?
Okay. He's supportive of it now.
Great.
And, you know, behind the scenes, too, we've been applying for the school resource officers. We're currently, one COPS grant just ran out, and you know, we're not laying the person off. We got other patrols for that person to cover them until February, when this, the last part of the last year of his position, but we're looking to renew that with some of the federal monies that are out there. And I'll apply for at least one, if not two already.
Yes. One of the challenges that we had with the Randolph Police Department was that we had one officer, one position unfilled. And correct me if I'm wrong, Sheriff and Captain, but my understanding is that, and this is also through conversations with our former chief, is that we were not allowed to apply for a COPS grant if it was going to be used to subsidize a vacant position. And in this case, that was a challenge with the school district. But now that, you know, we have this, at the very least, a short-term agreement, the school district can actually apply for a school resource officer through the Sheriff's Department, because now that's an option that's available to them. So school district is supportive. They have budgeted in their now existing budget for a resource officer, and they're moving forward with it.
Yeah, if you don't know this, you probably do, but we've been, Sergeant Gail Lund has been working with, was working with Loretta. They're both lead instructors in place of their program. And I believe we dispatched 120 kids right here in Randolph, between Randolph, Brookfield, and Braintree. That went through the program. So,
cool.
The DARE program, it's kind of slowly going away. The LEADS program taking over. It's law enforcement against drugs.
Mm-hmm.
It's evidence-based program. Soon we mentioned to the superintendents and principals, they did their own research, and next thing you know is they went into schools, because we went from four schools teaching DARE to 11 schools in 1 year.
Hmm. His liaison thing to you.
This wasn't you? It was you.
Larry and
Matt. Wow. Yes. Your turn.
Yes, I'll make a motion to accept the Orange County Sheriff's Department contract.
All right, I'll second that.
Motion and a second. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed?
Can I ask a question?
Careful
on
what you ask for.
Now, is that the village contract?
Yeah.
Did you review the outside of the village?
We already did that, didn't we?
Well, I would. I think you're. Oh, you mean the.
Yeah, I know you received it.
Yeah.
It was.
That's something I neglected to put on the agenda. This is for the contract for the annual service that we have.
Yes.
For patrol, ski patrols and traffic enforcement in the town.
It's just renewing last
year. Just renewing last year, yeah, it's renewing the old contract. But I did put it on the agenda, so.
Well, actually, you kind of did.
Well, you did.
Orange County
Sheriff's
Department. Totally.
So that's, as far as I'm concerned, it's part of the deal, isn't it?
Yep.
It's a separate one, though, because the.
So I'm fine with, you know, if you want to renew it, I'll make a motion to renew that, too.
Well, do we have any information, cost?
You just told me. Just said it's about the same, right?
It's the same renewal, but if it's easier, we could, I could share it through email.
Do you need it tonight?
No.
Then, okay.
No, I just want to, since you're talking about it. And just an FYI, the contract with the fire department, I think it's been going very well. 3 months have gone by, and we've finally figured out the static, you know, radios. And I just want to say thank you for, you know, we're moving forward with that, because now Williamstown wants to come on board, because they can hear the Randolph pulse clear as a bell in Williamstown. And so they want to come on board to us, too. So.
Good.
You had said you needed one more contract really to make that financially stable for you. That's good. We can circulate that other contract and then vote and then just ratify it August.
Too. Okay, I'll do that. It's my fault I forgot to put it on. I'll do that.
Not much difference. Not much
difference.
Yeah.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Thank you. Like, just let you know, any questions at all, I know Trini has my number, but just feel free to share my number, especially my cell phone number, for any questions, concerns.
It works good when you're pulled over by one of his officers.
Is that right?
Thank you.
Thank you. All right.
Anticipation note request.
Yes. The town typically asks select board to authorize a tax anticipation note. This is just to ensure that we have sufficient cash on hand to pay you know, daily operations or regular operations.
Mm-hmm.
We normally do have cash flow issues, but we have large insurgents of cash right when bills are due, and then as we move forward after the first period, then we run a little thin until the next infusion of cash for the next bills, or bills are paid, tax bills and the like. We had a tax anticipation note in this last fiscal year. We did not have to draw from it, and from my understanding, we have not had to draw from a former tax anticipation note in most recent years. It does not cost the town any money to have this line of credit open. It will only cost the town money if we borrow from the $1 million, and only then for the amount that we borrow. But we don't anticipate borrowing, it's just a nice way to ensure that we have it.
Yeah. Yeah.
So if the line of credit's approved by the select board, and then you have to draw on, does that come back to the select board, or is that just something you can then draw on?
Hopefully the motion would be to approve the tax anticipation note, and then that authorize the town to
utilize it
as necessary. Yeah. But one of the things we will do is the motion could be contingent on the manager coming back to inform the board of, we're not just going to borrow $1 million.
Joyce makes the decision based on the finances of the town, when she needs to pull money down or when she doesn't. That's usually how it works.
I am.
I got through a whole meeting without doing it earlier this year. I move we authorize town staff to advertise and obtain a tax anticipation note in the amount of $1 million.
Second.
Motion and a second. All
those in favor?
Aye. Opposed? Abstained? Motion carries. Two Rivers RPC RPC request.
Is for the Brownfields assessment of the Grinchville property. Sorry, I'm just trying to keep up with the minutes here. Shannon is on vacation this week.
This is the no fee one, right?
Yeah, why not?
That's right, yeah. So, Two Rivers Adequici has asked the town to include, has asked for permission to include the Branchwood property into their brownfield assessment study. This is funded through US EPA directly to Two Rivers Adequici. In our meeting with them, we said, well, you know, that's not what was on that site. It wasn't a company that would essentially create a brownfield. They clarified and said that their request isn't because they feel that it would be a brownfield. They just feel that the town could benefit from the study and clarifying that it is not, regardless of what was there in the past, and it's clear. They don't have any evidence again to suggest that it is or was or is contaminated. They just are looking for publicly owned properties to include in their assessment.
Publicly owned.
We have not committed to them. We said that, you know, we would need permission from the select board to authorize this, and they agreed and said it was fine. So they're just waiting for our decision.
Would they do privately held land that might have a public use, like a pocket park site?
I did bring that up to them. They have yet to get back to me, but Two Rivers Adequici, the owners of that property, they are not opposed to it, but they are interested in hearing more about what it would mean to them if it was something was found, because at that point, the property, the parcel would be considered a brownfield.
Taking that to court.
Yes. So they're open to it. There is always the risk that, you know, an assessment is made and someone dropped a can of oil and just so happens that we sampled that one piece of land that would lead to other tests, but there's a risk.
Can we take this one too?
Yeah, take that one too.
I move we authorize Two Rivers to include Branchwood in its brownfield assessments in the town right now.
I'm sure their test holes are distance from the road.
Yeah, and apply to all local, state, and federal regulations. Is that it?
Okay. I'll second for you.
Motion and a second. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Abstained? Motion carries. Special appropriations policy update. This was Joyce's request of the 40 versus 47 days that the statute was changed to.
Oh, yes.
Do we need to discuss it, or can I just keep on a roll?
I think you could just keep right on rolling. I don't think this one requires a whole lot of thought, does it?
A little language added.
Yeah.
There were two changes. The first change is to make us compliant with state law. It was
right.
Just 4047. The second change is to essentially make it more difficult for any organization to come to the town and request an appropriations directly from the taxation process, and then turn around and apply for special appropriations. This proposed change would allow the town to essentially tell this organization, we will work with you in good faith, we will, you know, find money through the taxation process to give to you, but they have to commit to not going to the special appropriations process. Currently, if an organization comes to the town, the select board, and they make this promise, there's nothing to essentially hold their feet to the fire. This would allow the select board and the town to say, well, we asked you not to do this, you agreed. We can't stop them from going through the special appropriations process, but we can, however, reduce the total amount that was appropriated through the tax process.
Whose feathers are that going to ruffle?
State church. They can go one process or the other. It's when they want to increase the amount of money they're getting, they can go into the budget to get more money, then they don't have to get the signatures of the voters.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
But the whole system of special appropriations is set up in statute for a reason.
Mm-hmm.
If you want an increase, you got to go back out and get enough people to support you getting that increase to get on the special appropriations ballot for a higher amount.
It's the need for the 5%.
Yeah.
Okay.
So some sort of moving effect thing, like the Airbus, those kind of things, those projects that have over the years been supported by the community, whose best appropriations wouldn't really have a bearing on them much or not.
Only if they decided they wanted to come in and get a budget line
right.
item also.
Exactly. So
and
most,
then the town could
don't.
Still fund both.
Right.
But if you get into a tight budget year, it gives you that ability to say,
nope.
I'm sorry, but
I should mention that prior to the start of the meeting, I received an email message from the town attorney. Although he did not have any problems with the language that was introduced for the board to consider, he did make some changes in that he made a few bold items, he italicized a few things. So I'd like to essentially say that what you have in front of you is, although it's accurate, it's not the version that our attorney sent to us in that it doesn't have the captions in the bold. It's all in here, it's just not in the format he returned to us.
Style.
Yeah, style.
Style over content.
Yeah.
So, make us see that.
Whether words italicized or bold,
yeah,
it's going to
make
a
really
difference in your
difference.
Opinion.
I don't know if you necessarily see it. Tell me, not substantial changes to language, just highlighting some points.
Yep.
Is there a way we can approve this with a follow-up to get that final language for a final approval?
Yeah.
I don't know how we do that.
Well, we could always just approve the date change and leave the other for another meeting.
The number of days.
Yeah.
But the italicized and the bold is stuff that's already in there, or is it stuff in
that's
the,
right.
It was in the old policy.
So the old policy.
Or the old ordinance and mm-hmm. whatever it is. And
so we could, if I could suggest, partially what Michael, you suggested was to approve the date change in accordance with the state, and then also just say, well, conditionally approve the language so long as it's concurrent with what our attorney applied with earlier. So this way, if there are any substantial changes,
we'll get a look at it.
Then you'd get a
yeah.
look at it. Yeah. But otherwise, if there are not any changes, then it would apply.
Got to come to us for signature anyway.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Hmm.
I move we do that. So I'll make a motion we approve special appropriation policy from the 40 to the 47 calendar days, with an understanding that we'll see the final language of the administrative edits, syntax, and so forth for final approval.
That work for you, Alpha?
First for me.
Second. Motion
and second. All those in favor?
Aye.
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 Opposed? Abstained? Motion carries.
This is an approved change of 40 to 47 days. I need to review other changes. Style. Future. Okay.
Next, we have grants.
We have four requests for grants. The East Randolph Community Group has requested from the town its support to apply for a grant to the Preservation Trust of Vermont. The group is aware of the amount of work that it will require to bring East Randolph Hall back into compliance. And this grant, through our conversations, is one of the first steps that we need to take. This grant will allow the group to have a foundation study performed. The town would, if approved, the town would provide a $500 match for the grant. Preservation Trust of Vermont would provide the other $500, and the entire foundation assessment would be done for $1,000. At this point, we will have a clear understanding of what the foundation is like. We have performed a property inspection that has told us that there are issues with the foundation. We just don't know exactly how bad the issues are. and the Preservation Trust of Vermont will help us to, through an expert, figure out exactly just how bad the foundation problems are as we try to.
They're just applying for a grant at this point.
Right? That's right, just applying. Yes, Craig, to clarify, if the board were to approve the Preservation Trust grant, it would also need to approve a $500 match, which we do have through the Facilities Reserve Fund. We currently have money put aside for repairs of East Randolph Hall. Mm-hmm. We can
come
use
from
it.
That, right?
We can absolutely come from that.
What do you got working on that over there? Who took the lead on that? I'm just curious.
Mark, I forget Mark's last name. Mark. Josie Carruthers' husband.
Okay. I
forget Mark's last name.
Right.
But he has been working with Preservation Trust, and Betsy Race is also involved.
Betsy, John Pimenthal,
that whole group
was okay. So that they're all connected now, and
they're all on. Yeah, it's the same page, same
yeah.
group.
Yeah. Right. All right. Okay. Well, I'll make a motion to approve that request and provide the matching $500 if needed.
Second.
Motion and second. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Abstained? Yes. Rural Fire Protection District Dry Hydrant Grant.
This is a request that was submitted. The request is that there's a failing dry hydrant in the town. T.J. Riley is a local resident who's worked with the town in the past to install this dry hydrant. The hydrant that was installed late last year is malfunctioning. And the request is that the town apply for this grant, mostly because the grant can't be issued to a private property owner. So the private property owner has agreed to pay for any matching costs for repairs. It just would like the town to apply for the grant on their behalf, act as an in-between, usher the funds from the Rural Protection District to the work that's being done, and then all costs would be covered by the property owner. Any costs that would be incurred by the town would be covered by the private property owner.
Mm-hmm. This is the hydrant in East Randolph off Silverway Road. It worked in the fall. It's not working now. Troy Dare is...
Didn't we apply for a grant for them last year?
We got the grant to install it, and they installed it. But I know that the email that Troy sent had a bunch of stuff. They think something came apart in it, so he's willing to give us a grant.
Was this on the front porch for him a couple weeks ago? Somebody was looking for a scuba diver for one of these projects.
That was
isn't the one?
That was not the
that's something else?
They need to dig it up and
okay.
look and see where it came apart and fix it. They think there also might be a part that failed. But
mm-hmm.
Troy was willing to give a grant for the $500 to cover the cost of it, of fixing it. But it is the one we did last year. We did $5,000 or $5,500 or something he gave.
Did this one go through Fire Advisory this week?
Not this week, but we've talked about it before. I think there was conversation about the validity of the dry hydrant, whether it was useful or not, but because it wasn't costing the town anything, the decision was that there was no reason to oppose it because it's there, and if we ever need it, we could use it.
Well, each town goes into a list. And so if we accept grant funds, we go to the bottom of the list. So if we have a dry hydrant that comes up.
He said this one won't impact anything. This is his way of getting basically the money to do the warranty work, is how he was labeling it. But yeah, normally if we accepted the $5,000 to put in a new hydrant, we drop. I think we're already still dropped.
Yeah.
We're working our way up the list. This is, I don't know, he explained it that they know it's not in the main line going into the pond. They think it's somewhere in the hydrant itself. And the chances are we're not even going to need the grant because they're going to figure out it's mechanical and put it back on the manufacturer. But the grant is just so TJ doesn't have to pay the $500 out of pocket if the repairs end up being something that's not warranted. I think that's what I got out of it.
That's right.
So there's no financial risk to them?
Yeah.
As long as it doesn't drop to my list, I'm fine with it.
Is that a motion?
No,
kind of sounded like it.
This is the fire guys, they're going to let them deal with that one.
All right, I'll make a motion for the tri-hydrant. You turned up so low. Is it 500?
Second.
Motion and a second. All those in favor?
Aye.
Hey, it was awful time to write.
Oh, I see what you're doing.
You're so
giving them time to write. Okay. All right.
So when does the town, this next one, the restorative justice grant, when does the town get to reevaluate this whole program? If they just keep giving it to us as an amendment each year, and this will be the fourth year that they've just amended. So you don't get to look at what the town doesn't get a say in anything about the program at that point.
Yeah, the reason for this increase is that we have been vocal with the program coordinators in saying that although we appreciate the work that they're doing, we don't feel that Randolph should be a final destination for a certain population. They agreed. They thought it was, you know, not being insensitive to the population that is being serviced through this grant. The local program coordinator that works with the town also has expressed an interest in making this a county-wide grant. So this way, it's not just the town of Randolph that's servicing this group. The reason why they're requesting this extension is because they want to go back out to bid so that they move out of Randolph and we are no longer just sole recipients of the target population. We made it very clear that, again, we appreciate the work, but we want to share the wealth on this one. And they understood. They just asked for 6 more months so they can go out to bid and find a new home for it.
This is the group that does COSA, whatnot, all good things. It's folks with sex crimes, basically, when they come to get out of prison. And right now, because we have the program here, they all have to reside in Randolph.
Mm-hmm.
So when we say we want to share the wealth, mm-hmm. like those that were offenders from Bradford, Brookfield, can
yeah.
go back to their hometown.
Yeah.
And not all have to reside in downtown
Randolph. Yeah, I'm familiar with this because I get solicited to hire them.
That's kind of some of the thought behind making them increase the size of the area they're covering in the training.
Cool. Needs to be shared. Yep. Okay.
But in the meantime, we have to extend the grant the way it is to cover Tim's salary.
I believe at this point there are roughly about 16 to 20 members of this particular population in the town.
She's working with. There's some others that are still here that have graduated.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. But, yeah. Big group.
It takes 6 months to do this bid?
Yeah, the state's doing it.
Oh, so that's on probably
yeah. nine. But we've said to them that if the board agrees to the extension that, you know, we would agree to 6 months, and the contract itself says that we could give them notice and then just terminate. This is just more out of goodwill and saying we'll work with you for the next
they'll
6 months.
They'll have to bid it and then they'll have to transition it.
Yeah.
Okay. All right, so I'll make the motion to approve the grant for the restorative justice grant extension. Where's Larry?
I'll second.
Motion and a second, all those in favor?
Aye.
Municipal highway and stormwater mitigation grant.
The town recently learned that this grant opportunity is available. It will allow us to apply for funding to build a new salt shed in the village highway built structure. That shed is in need of a lot of improvements and we really could use a new shed. That's just one of the projects that we could apply for. We would have to work with our highway superintendent to see if this project or another highway project could be a priority. But we would like the board's approval to be able to apply for funding through this grant. With the salt shed potentially being the top.
That'd be the top priority.
The top priority.
This is the same program that they're also using to line, do all the riprap in the ditches and that kind of stuff.
It would also does stormwater mitigation.
Doesn't it fall into that category?
Well, there's also Better Roads. Better Roads also does. So a lot of them have similar things.
Missed.
We missed the most recent one, but we do have one for, not Hollyhock, Braintree Hill. So we have a $26,000 grant for that.
Your turn.
I'll make a motion we accept the request for municipal highway and stormwater mitigation grant application process. Make sure we have all the right adjectives and nouns.
Second.
Motion and a second. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Abstained? Motion carries. Old business. Animal control wolf hybrid directive.
The select board approved the signing of this letter at the last meeting, but it was not signed by the board, so brought it back so that it would be signed, and I put it in the signature packet. That's the only reason why it's on the agenda. Mm-hmm.
Acceptance of a water main for the LED project. So this is the one we got in our packet. Is there any changes after?
No changes. There were no changes from the attorneys that shared this with the town. Our attorney, I shared my concern with our attorneys in that. On page 2, the very top track change talks about potential contaminants or, you know, chemicals, anything that could be used on the site that could contaminate the area. I shared with our attorney and said that I was concerned with, for example, if we used any kind of fire retardant or any other issue that was needed to fight fire or anything that we needed to do, this particular language prohibits us from using. Our attorney, right before the start of the meeting, sent an updated version. The language was essentially the same, but he did add a caveat at the end of that sentence that made the exception for fire protection, fire prevention. There was a concern in that the actual easement deed didn't actually make it to the town, didn't make it to my desk until yesterday. I believe it was late Tuesday, so we didn't want to essentially pass it on to the board to say you have to consider this at the last minute because it's needed, but I also wanted to make sure that the board was aware that this actually made its way to the town, albeit a little late, and necessarily give as much time for you to review. It is the same project that we've been talking about. It is essentially the same issue in accepting the water main from Hingville Road further down, and this is just addressing the very first portion of it that only covers all the way up to the end of the Freedom Foods building and not the second portion of it to everything.
So basically the edge of the parking lot from in the middle of the edge of the parking lot is what this piece covers.
Yeah, that's what this piece covers.
And then
there's no language in here though. There's actually language that says it's a non-exclusive right away. Yeah. There's nothing in there to prohibit them from burying fiber line right on top of our water line.
Hmm.
It's So then when we go to dig up our water line, guess what else we're going to get? We talked about them not being able to put additional utilities within a certain proximity of that water line.
Oh, that would be for the, this is for the existing water line, the one that's already there. I see what you're saying, that even with this one, you could still bury more into it.
If you're going to continue it along, you wouldn't want to be running into that problem from the Beanville Road up to the edge of the parking lot.
Yeah, we have resolved the issue from the edge of the parking lot to LED in that they have agreed to remove the utility easement. In this section, I'd have to reread it to look at the point that you're making, Trini, but yeah, it could be that there is a utility easement here that I just haven't seen. But I do know that for the second portion of it, we have made that correction.
Wording aside, I'm still not going to be sold on why we would do this to begin with.
The only reason we would do it is because LED needs to be hooked into that water line as well as anything else that they need water out there for. I don't know if there's, maybe 30 years from now, somebody else will go out there, but.
I get that.
That's the gist of the reason they're doing it. The only other thing that would, they're already having to pay Freedom Foods a chunk of the cost for that water line anyway.
Right, so why should we even get in the middle of it?
The only thing I understand is that it's to preserve the ability to put more on, but we don't have to.
That's at least 5 years out.
Oh, easy.
At least.
Two and a half.
I thought it was
22. Two and a half. Positive thinking over here.
That was 2022.
2021, I think.
Okay. So let's say 3 years, round off.
Okay.
Then another year, at least, so before something can be built. I don't know. I'm just not sold on doing it. Especially if they're paying them a bunch of money to hook into it anyway.
My understanding is they have. They had to pay them 50% of the construction cost,
if
I remember correctly.
I thought I heard
that's pretty typical.
Yeah.
But
yeah, I mean, that's a standard thing.
Yeah,
I mean, you
that's
pick
standard.
Up the half of the cost of developing the line,
yeah.
Which I think is fair.
Yeah, I agree. But to me, everything's already done, taken care of. They get the maintenance from there up, they split the maintenance from there down. It only ends up costing us money in the long term. Our attorney's fees to develop it, our maintenance and everything, when something may never go out there.
So maybe they should pay the town the $17,500.
I said that at the last meeting and the meeting before. I said, as long as we're getting the $17,500, sure, let's take it over. But oh, absolutely.
And then
I just
no, it's been a pretty nice. Yeah, I think they were here again on Monday trying to finalize this. So,
what does it do to their whole scheme if the town doesn't take that line over?
It would create problems in that they're anticipating the town being able to take over this entire main line. There are the financial implications of finances being exchanged between LED and Freedom Foods. The issue itself is very complicated with all of the players already involved. So the town not agreeing to do this would add some complications. I wouldn't say that it would jeopardize the project altogether, but it could create considerable problems between all of the players involved. Between Green Mountain, between Freedom Foods, between Lucky Gimmick, or Lucky. So they're. We wouldn't stop the project, but.
If they paid them the money already, didn't they have some sort of agreement that says we can hook in we'll split these costs are ours, didn't they already cover all that? Did they just say, wait, the town of Randolph's going to bail us all out of this argument?
I could check.
Yeah.
Because if they didn't have an agreement in place to begin with, that's on them.
Yeah.
Right.
The
so if they already have an agreement,
begins, then they have to.
Yeah.
No, there's legal agreements that have to be. There's,
right.
There's
so if they already have the agreement to tie in and they're all set, I just don't think we should get involved in it. I don't see the benefit for us.
What's the cost to us to take this on?
I don't have that.
If you're on the table, Jerry.
Okay, it's Marty left.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, I mean, what's our exposure to taking it on? I mean, I'm kind of on the side of this that's like, okay, we're here, they're moving forward, we want to encourage economic development. I don't want to be in a situation where we're holding them back any further, because I do know that right now there have been some issues down here, and that's why things haven't happened yet.
Yeah.
So, you know, I want to see the project move forward, and so where are we at risk here? What do we...
Long-term exposure is that if the mains were to break,
yeah,
then the town is completely on the hook to fix them. It could be anywhere from, you know, digging one small area, patching it up, to an entire completely new piping, which would require a few tens of thousands of dollars.
30 years out.
Yeah. The line itself is relatively new.
Yeah.
So there are some years of life.
You know, what's the line constructed with? What's the built as?
Chris and Marty review this line to see if it meets something that we, if we were to install it, meet the same standards.
We set the standards.
We set the standards in the beginning, didn't we?
Doesn't mean it was built that way.
I know. We set the standards, though. I know one that went in because there was that whole pushback from when all that went in. He didn't want to have to do the size and whatever.
Right. But it was sized according to be able to take on extra friction development, right?
Well, I know the instructions were given it was sized, but I don't know, like Mike said, what he actually did.
As-built.
Is there any as-builts to this? I mean, do we know?
He inspected it.
Seems like that might be something we should look at is, okay, where are the engineering plans that shows how this was built, right? You should want to see that, I would think. I don't think that's unreasonable to ask for.
No, not at all. I mean, I could certainly have that conversation with them, and I know Marty's been involved in the process. I don't have as much information as she
does. Maybe that's an answer Marty can give us relatively quickly.
Yeah, I can do that.
So, I mean, I don't see it taking on as a huge liability for the town to take it on, other than any future maintenance issues, but, you're the engineering type of person, so.
Well, just from a financial standpoint, we're going to take it on, and we're not going to see any increase in revenue. We're just going to see an increase in expenses. So to me, it's a net loss, no matter what
we
do.
Well, an increase in expenses, if you have to maintain it, right?
Everything has to be maintained.
I understand, but we're talking lots of years of revenue here from...
But it's the same revenue whether we take it on.
I got that part, too. I understood that, it's the same revenue either way. So...
I could ask Marty to provide me with more detail, and I could share it with the board in terms of the engineering specs, the material that makes up the pipe, whether it's whatever it is, and I could share with the board.
When we were asked to take this on, was this a result of the whole process of moving that project forward down there?
Yes. It would make it easier for the town to, and also for the developers to, develop in the future if we needed to expand the potential business park area, add more businesses into that area, which I know is maybe a problem in the future, but
stand on this one.
Yeah, you understand it.
But to speak to Mike, to your point, yes, there is a risk. The pipe could break the day after we take it on. It could not break for 20, 30 years. But the benefit is, the downside is we do assume that risk. The benefit is, if we do have potential developers that want to come in very soon, we could immediately expand the water system, even if they offered to pay for it.
So I guess from a general planning perspective, where we lived for quite a while, the developers, the owners of the property who developed the property for the businesses or subdivision, whatever, maybe they took on all the costs, all the risks, all the whatever, right? And the homeowners or the business went in and bought the land and put their structures on there. To me, I mean, it's not a town road going in there. It's all private property. This is Lucky, right, developing his property appropriately as he can. And, you know, to me, that burden should fall on him or his business to be taken down. But that's just an opinion. I don't think I'm going to have a vote on this, honestly.
The work that was done from the curb to Freedom Foods was part of their project.
That's right.
And it was part of the grant, the CDBG grant.
Right.
Yeah.
No, I understand.
But you could argue they shouldn't have been able to charge LED dynamics for
it. Well, that was going to be my point. If it was part of the CDBG grant, then how did they get to charge for that?
Well, you know.
Knowing the players, I can understand how that might have occurred. So, I'd like to see the engineering, I guess, just to see what, you know, what is it? You know, is it HPVE pipe or is it, you know, metal or what is it? Because it had to do with black stuff. It's supposed to last 100 years, ain't it? No? That's funny. That's what he told me when I bought it.
They don't put in the stuff that lasts 100 years. They had construction issues. I could certainly see them reducing size.
You think they might have changed that? Yeah, okay.
I think it's a possibility.
Yeah, okay.
Know.
Well, I guess that's
best. I don't know
enough,
but I do know they had construction issues.
So I'd like to see what's in the ground then. So I think that should be real easy to find, I think.
Should get more info.
So can I ask just another clarification? So on this wording for all the contaminants and what they're not allowed to bring into that easement while they're doing construction and all that, they're allowed to do that out on the actual construction area. They just can't do it where this, from the road to Freedom Foods where they connect, right?
They can't store it. They can't do
right.
certain types
of
maintenance.
Only as far as this original one.
Yeah.
That's what I'm at. From
yeah.
the road
the
to Freedom
Foods.
Foods.
Yeah.
yeah. Okay.
So are we going to see
it's only
the other easement
that
at the same time so we can make sure they're consistent?
It's only the town that
can't
do it.
Because yeah,
the easement
make sure that
is
on
ours.
I
think we should.
So it doesn't mean
you
can't.
Accept,
but
I
mean,
it
just means
be
we can't.
On it.
But,
because we're the ones.
Oh, I was thinking the construction company.
Yeah. Can't do more of
that.
No.
No. Because they shouldn't be in that area to begin with. They wouldn't be operating under our easement.
Yeah, both,
right?
They would be operating under the other easement.
Gotcha.
Because they should be similar.
Yeah, they should be the same. I had expressed concern with one over the other. What was explained to me that I did not necessarily agree with was that it's a part of the process. This one goes first, and then the next one goes. And my thought was, well, this is all the same project, so we should all look at it the same. There was conversation about whether or not to even include this on here. But we put it in here again just so that we can have this discussion. If there are issues, we can go back and not essentially encourage the board not to make a decision right away, just to have a conversation so that when we bring it up later on, there's an actual conversation with what the board needs, which is specs, engineering, and everything else.
Okay, more info.
All right. Other business.
Not for me, no.
The only item I have under other business is we still haven't set a date to meet to go over priorities, goals. We talked about doing a retreat to set direction.
Mm-hmm.
We put dates out there and we didn't come up with anything.
Well, Saturday.
But not during golf season, right?
While you're in England?
Yeah, that'd be perfect week.
From the
two of you go to Australia.
So in all honesty, I'm booked through the 24th of August. We'll travel or
which time are you thinking you need for this? Is this like a
I think it's only like
afternoon?
Yeah, like maybe 3 hours.
Yeah.
If that it's just you know, what do we want to focus on? What do we want to get done? It plays into any ability for Adolfo to give direction to to some of these groups who work with and whatnot. So one of the things that comes to mind is our ACDC. They have a whole list of the downtown program, but we haven't said this is our priorities.
Right.
So it's hard to work and give them a direction to implement a plan.
Right.
If we haven't said this,
if we haven't set
what we want to have
priorities, right? Okay.
Through August 24th.
I'm gone, yeah. I'm here next week, on 2 weeks, and then on travel 3 weeks.
Okay.
So I'm officially in town the week of the 30th, but that's a vacation week. I've already been called into a meeting that week.
It's hell to be popular, isn't it?
Retirement's only 20 years away. Yeah, I mean, if you want to send them sooner, I mean, there's weekend in there, obviously.
If you're down all the time, you have more time with your family, too. Maybe.
The kids have seen them enough.
Yeah, they don't have to
be. Is everybody else's schedules look like?
Well, I'm just busy through October. Whatever we need to do, we'll figure it out.
First couple weekends in August are bad, but other than that, good. And then the first couple in September.
Do nights or weekends work better than during the week? Obviously, for traveling, they do.
No Wednesdays. Other than that, you can skip Friday
mornings.
Okay.
Bigger group of it?
Golf. He's prayed a lot. I prayed a lot last night. You didn't know. I lost my balls last night, the previous month at golf.
Yeah. Where are you? What are you thinking?
So Wednesdays are out, and we're looking at whether an evening or a weekend works better for folks.
Typically, my day off is Saturday, so that's my non-busy day. So I can do something until we get to Labor Day weekend, of course.
Saturday morning? Saturday morning.
I can do a Saturday morning or something.
Saturday morning, at least we have the rest of the weekend. Okay. So let's go with a Saturday morning.
Do a doodle poll.
We did that before and then it never got scheduled.
Oh,
yeah. We had like one response.
Oh, really?
Oops.
Yeah.
It was mine.
No.
Okay, next Saturday available.
Next Saturday is probably.
No, not next Saturday. I'm out of time.
Yeah, me too.
Me too. Sorry.
Next 3 Saturdays, I am.
So, next 3
so
Saturdays.
So we're at August 11th?
August 11th.
I am unavailable the 11th.
So that puts us to the 18th. The morning of the 18th?
Sure. I'm okay with that one.
Okay.
Either flying to England or coming back, so I'm not sure. So, simple, do it. Let's,
take
they got Wi-Fi on the plane.
There you go.
All right, August 18th. What time?
6:30 in the morning?
Yeah.
Sure.
I don't care. Early as you want.
I'm right across the street, so.
Okay.
No, it's a retreat. We're not doing
anything. Yeah.
Was it breakfast? I'm thinking Ben Hill.
Should be, right?
Should be.
Six
6:30, you're not going to have the cater for that.
8 o'clock.
8 o'clock. Okay.
We'll get a location figured out.
Get a location worked out, yep.
Okay. manager's report.
I have new items to share. I can find my report. Okay. One is the ongoing conversation with the Preservation Trust of Vermont over their proposal to potentially offer the town a half acre on the 22 and a half acres that was purchased off exit 4. Preservation Trust feels that they could potentially reduce the size down to a quarter acre. They had a preference over a quarter acre, but if the town had a preference, they could bring it back up to a half acre. One of the reasons that I was told for the town's involvement in this particular arrangement was to ensure that the sculpture, Whale's Dance, is to remain in Randolph long term. One of the suggestions that I made is that if the town is being brought in for this particular purpose is to attach all conservation easements for the half acre to the sculptures. And if the sculptures were to ever be taken away, then the town would be free to sell the half acre with no restrictions, and anyone can build whatever they'd like. The suggestion was not approved, and as a counter, the suggestion made to the town was to instead include the town into a three-way committee between Preservation Trust and the owners of the sculpture, and that the town and all partners involved in the committee would have to decide in order for the sculptures to be moved at any point in the future. So that was the most final, the most recent suggestion from Preservation Trust. So again, the conversations are ongoing. We don't have a resolution on whether the town would be responsible insurance-wise for the sculpture, the responsibility for maintenance, the responsibility for just cleanliness of the area. Those are all topics that are still to be determined. But at the very least, one of the items is that the property could either be half acre, quarter acre, but it would come with full restrictions on what could be on the property if the Whale's Dance were to be.
I thought we couldn't do the half acre because it's only.
Yeah.
Right, they would have to seek a variance in the ordinance or a change.
And they can't spot zone.
So what was the advantage of the Whale's Tails? I mean, no one here, so the Whale's Tails, did that bring people here to spend money and visit Randolph? Was it an attraction? I'm trying to figure out what the benefit to the town is, was. And I'll admit I'm not an art head guy, so I don't have an appreciation for art and all that.
Me neither, but they put us on the map. So you can still Google this and find these things, you know, Google art, you know, and Google a number of different articles about where they were, how they came to be here, how they were funded and financed and those kind of things. So there's a lot of people, you know, in the community who over the years, you know, saw this as a loss when they left. So
can we tear down the gazebo and put it there? I mean, we're wanting business, you know, businesses down.
Yeah, no,
people spend money, but all we're doing is, and I have no problem, but making, you know, giving more traffic to the Barn and McDonald's in that case.
Yeah, well, and yeah. So, anyways, the
go to Subway.
They don't really
give the traffic. There were lots of conversations about things that could happen up there, and so, but this one here is kind of a gift that appears to have found its way back to the community. So supporting, you know, I'm feeling it's something that we should do. I just don't know how to work out the legal land agreement because of the requirements of the zoning situation. So,
but again, if it's a private property, it's kind of a private donation.
Yeah. I think the goal behind it was is that this way no one could actually say, oh, we're going to get rid of them again. So if the town had a say in it, so my understanding was, and I had a little bit of a conversation with Duffel about this, that the process would be that there would be three entities involved and no one could make the decision to move them without the other two's involvement. Is that correct?
That's right. That's the most recent proposal.
Right.
Do all three have to agree for it to, or can two outvote?
No.
No.
All three would have to agree if they were to be moved.
Yeah.
And so it's pretty unlikely that you would get the. It's the Vermont Community Fund, Preservation Trust, in the town. That's why they'd like the town's involvement, so that there would be secure this situation, so it couldn't be.
Or they could just make it so it stays and it can't be moved.
Yeah, anything that works to get that accomplished would be fine. And whatever legal document needs to be drafted to make that happen. But I thought my understanding was they thought this would be the best solution so that the community had involvement in it and wasn't just somebody else's decision.
I thought the last meeting when we talked about this, they were going to present to us what all the restrictions were that they wanted,
right.
Who was going to mow around it, how people were going to get to it, who was going to pick up the McDonald's
right.
garbage that was going to be over there, like all
and
those things.
If a kid falls off the top of it.
Yeah, whose is it?
Did we get that far yet?
No. We wanted to make sure we clarified, at the very least, the specifics about why is the town involved. You know, what happens if the sculptures you just pick up and go? My suggestion was to ensure that they would stay because then we could build a skyscraper in a half acre. But there is some assurance with a tri group to at the very least give the town a deciding factor in this. This is all still very fluid, still preliminary. But again, the Preservation Trust is open to certain types of conversations, at the very least about maintenance and insurance and everything else.
I think it's an interesting concept of if the sculpture is to bring people to Randolph and get them into an area more where everything else is going on, why not locate it in the downtown?
Yeah. I could certainly bring that up.
It means it's where the gazebo is now, so we don't have to drug what's going on there.
Well, there was a greater vision of more sculpture throughout the community, and this would be the key piece. So there's a piece right now that's going to the Baptist Cemetery that's being done by Karen Peterson's, which is going to be in a bronze. There's also the piece that she did down at Chandler. So there's been more conversations about locating more and more pieces here to create kind of a sculpture tour. So for some people, that's kind of an important thing. So I don't know, this would definitely be, because it was there, because why...
But to me, if one of our goals is to build business up here to get more people visiting our businesses, let's start with the first one or the first big one.
Yeah, and that has a little bit to do with the aesthetics of the background behind it too. So, I mean, that's what originally was going on there. Mm-hmm. So, Google up there, just Google up with.
No, I remember seeing them. I remember them there, and I just wasn't a resident of Randolph
at the time. At the time, the situation was it was commissioned by David Thoreau-Kell because he owned the land at the time. And he wanted to build a hotel out in the back where the cornfield was, and so this was going to be this monumental piece that was going to be the entryway to the hotel. So that's what and then apparently, from my understanding, was Jim had actually proposed what he's going to build now first, but it got pared down to what we had, and so now this is an opportunity for him to recreate what he originally was going to propose or what he was going to do. So that's why it's a little different than what was now sitting up beside Technology Park.
Yeah.
So
one other challenge that did come up, so Paul did mention that from their perspective, the Whale's Dance and this quarter or half acre, from their perspective, is completely different from the issue that's ongoing about the tax for the 22 and a half acres.
Mm-hmm.
Our conversation was, again, we're both being very frank. I said, well, it could be potential to muddy the waters. He understood from my perspective, but also then said that from their perspective, they're considering it two separate issues. So if the board and the town were to choose to enter into this agreement, we could potentially craft language that said, this is independent from the other, the town does not agree or feels a certain way about 22 and a half acres, but in this case, we do or do not agree. So, but again, this is all
with
still...
With it being municipal land, we just jack up the value of that. It makes it worth that much more because it's comparable to signage.
That's why I brought it up in the manager's report, just as a matter of this is ongoing and happening.
It's an ongoing conversation.
May I just add a little question? If I can have the landscape.
Yeah.
I'm not going to try to speak for Preservation Trust, but I think I have a pretty good sense of where they're coming from. And
the notion that this might be a sculpture that would be downtown is a non-starter. It's been commissioned to be up at that spot. It's what the perception of people who have donated a lot of money for it, where they want it. I think it's got widespread popular acclamation regionally, if not in Randolph itself. And that's where I think I can confidently say it's going to go. I think the question that I'm not really hearing the right slant on it that seems appropriate is that the town has a choice about whether to take it on. This is an opportunity. This is not a threat. And I don't think the Preservation Trust really cares one way or the other. They're going to do it regardless. And I think the question is whether the town can see this as an opportunity, mainly to have some control over what is going to be an iconic gateway emblem for Randolph. And it's going to be something that people talk about to photograph. It's going to be on postcards, if postcards still exist. It's going to be on web pages. It's going to be our symbol.
The whale's dance?
What's that?
A whale's dance would be the town symbol.
I can guarantee, in my vision, I shouldn't say it, in my vision, it's going to be a return of an iconic symbol that
many
of us remember.
I agree with that. I mean, I think that was one of the key pieces here for years was that was kind of like Randolph was the place for the whale's tails, regardless of how crazy people might have thought it was still something that people tripped their trigger when they were driving through the region. So
I think I heard one of the crazy comments.
Oh yeah, no,
we love it and we want it back comments.
There's a lot of people that just they don't get it, so that's okay. There's some art that I don't get, you know. There's some over on Main Street I don't understand.
Other sculptures in town, that would be cool, but it's not a sit a quid pro quo. So I wouldn't mix it up with that either, but that's just the way I see it. Thank you for listening.
What else you got on your
Got a few more things. The second is just a way to continue promoting Randolph. I've been in town at the end of this month, it'll be 11 months. And I see how, I love it here, my house. I see the potential, and I see how I don't want to leave anytime soon. Hint, hint, the board.
Which brings up the next topic.
Yeah, right. Executive
session.
The next item kind of relates to all of the good things that are happening in Randolph. The energy, R3, the expanding of local businesses, and how they kind of would help the town just to help us to promote the town. There is a program called the All American City. And we're not a city, but they also do accept towns. Something that recently popped up. It's not something that we have put any energy into yet, but would like to really share with the board that at some point share with staff to see if it's something that we can apply for. It's more a way for us to, again, promote Randolph, promote all the good things that are happening, and then if we are selected, we would receive the brand of All American Hammer. The last time anyone from Vermont received this, only once before, was Brattleboro in 1956.
Wow.
So it's been a while, and I do feel that a lot of the good things happening in Randolph could make us a big contender. Next item is the pool repairs. The repairs themselves are ongoing. The investigating of the issues are also ongoing. We just performed some pressure tests of the main sewer line, or the main line at the bottom of the pool. The pressure came back great, so we know that it's not the pipe itself that's failed. We have found that four of the, what our staff are calling the headers at the bottom, are cracked. Those are roughly about $100 each, so those are quick, easy fixes. We have found that one of the main pressure lines that surrounds the pool on the outside, there's absolutely no pressure at all. So there is sort of major leaking happening in that one pipe. And that is a major infrastructure pipe for the pool. We are going to try to figure out exactly where the breaks are, and if there are more than one, then the issue then becomes how much will it cost, and if it's just easier to put a new one in. So we won't find that out until very least mid-next week, as we're still continuing with the investigation. We do have someone coming in early to mid-next week to perform ground penetrating radar. We understand that there's some issues with the technology, that it may not be as detailed as we would like or need it to be, but at the very least, the town would put some effort into seeing if there are any voids in the ground and what voids may exist. And if we could at the very least rule out a big part of the sinkhole issue, then we can continue with just the repairs of the piping itself. Mm. So we'll know more by next week. The International City and Town Managers Association just created a new section on their website that'll ask towns to submit something that they're potentially going to be repairing or that they may need money for. So what I did was submitted a request for proposals or request for information on designing for a new pool, repairs to massive leaking to a pool. ICMA will then send that out to a massive blast, and then we could collect some information on what other municipalities have paid for new swimming pools, for new designs, that kind of thing, just in case that it'll cost a considerable amount to repair our existing pool. It is almost 40 years old, so you know we could be in line for a new swimming pool. Which leads me to the next thing is that I have contacted the towns of Braintree and Brookfield, kind of gauged their interest on whether they would like to have a conversation on creating a tri-town recreation department. So this way we could potentially pool all of our recreational resources. The town of Randolph could decrease the amount of money it contributes towards recreation, Brookfield and Braintree, understanding that they also could benefit for Randolph's recreation, we could all potentially join together. Similar to what we have with the Mountain Alliance for Solid Waste Disposal, we could potentially have for recreation. The town of Braintree was open to it. The town of Brookfield, I've yet to hear back from them. They had a select board meeting earlier this week, but they seem to be interested in, at the very least, having a conversation. So hopefully they'll have more. The initial thought is to have a population breakdown for a recreational tri-town recreational budget. So it really depends on what opportunities we would have for recreation, but with the understanding that we would be potentially collecting money for Braintree and Brookfield to have a tri-town recreation area.
Kind of makes sense. I mean, they're participating in all our sports.
Yeah.
Teams and everything. That's a recreation.
Same thing. It's just everything that happens within the three communities.
Yeah.
So it's very initial. I hope to have more detail as we move along and work and then decide whether they'd like to continue with this or not. We received a notice from Stagecoach that they have been given a grant to expand their 89er South route. This brings folks from Randolph down to Lebanon. I just thought I would share that with the board because they are involved with the submitting comments to the town plan. We have had ongoing conversations with Stagecoach about funding in the past, so felt it would be beneficial to share that with the board.
Is that just more or bigger buses going that way, or expanding the number of times, or the number of days? Or
expand the number of times.
It's a frequency grant.
Yeah. Frequency.
And then they feel that they could also potentially increase feeder lines into that one line down to Tunbridge, Chelsea, Rochester, and Stockbridge. Mm-hmm. So just increasing their network a little bit. Actually, the last thing is I received a request from the Conservation Commission, Randolph Conservation Commission. They would like to have town staff and the board at some point readdress the Emerald Ash Borer Preparedness Plan, and would also like to potentially have a select board liaison so they could attend the RCC meetings and have a more direct connection to the select board and the commission. I suggested to them that we could potentially have a commission member attend the select board meetings and give a briefing, but something that we're just going back and forth on, that they would like to have a more direct connection.
Didn't I see something that's already here now?
And here.
Yeah, I think I saw that last week.
Yeah, I thought the last time we talked about that plan, they were going to work on a more realistic, instead of saying you can spend nothing or you can spend $1 million.
Yeah.
something that made a little more sense, what was realistic.
Yeah.
I don't know that we ever got anything.
Right.
I think the first time we asked them for that, then they came back and said, hey, you haven't adopted our plan. We said, oh, hey, you haven't given us a realistic look. And so now they're back saying, hey, you haven't adopted our plan. But, hey, you haven't given us a realistic.
Yeah.
Their meetings I've been to on it, they've been pretty clear that they don't want you clear cutting all the ash. And so that was their $1 million answer. So the plan draft that we have isn't in sync with what Forest and Parks are saying are best practices. So you were the ones I was at when they were like,
don't just
go clear cut, just let them do their thing and then clean up after them. Because we were like, let them go.
Years ago, we had this massive problem with gypsy moths,
armyworms,
and all kinds of things that affected the sugar bushes, you know. And you know, everybody was worried that the sugar bushes were going to be decimated and there'd be no more maple trees. And so here we are, you know, 30 years later, and it's kind of gone by the wayside. So, you know, and that was devastating, you know, hundreds of thousands of acres of Vermont forest at that point in time and multiple years. So, yeah, I think it's let it run its course and see what happens.
Matt, to answer your question, yes, EAD has been identified in Randolph and in the entire state. I think the last I heard is the entire state is now a quarantine zone, which means we cannot ship wood outside during the summer months. During the winter months, I believe it's okay to do that, but the wood would have to be processed at certain wood processing facilities. And the reason, my understanding, one of the reasons to make it a statewide quarantine is that this would...